Alrighty, first of all, thanks everybody for coming tonight. It's nice to see a turnout like this on a cold winter night. And I really hope this is gonna be a fun talk for everybody. You know, it's been, for those of us who are work in the field of wildlife conservation or who are just wildlife enthusiasts, there have been some rough years of late. And, you know, once in a while, and there's always a lot of challenges that we face in this career path, but once in a while, I think it's important to stop and kind of reassess and recognize some of the successes that we've had over the years and the decades, and just kind of recharge our batteries and, you know, enjoy some of the progress that we've made. And so that's going to be the theme tonight. This, we're not going to talk about a lot of negative things or hardships that we face ahead, recognizing that there are always challenges. But we're going to talk about the fun stuff and the good stuff for the most part tonight. And let's see. The other thing I want to challenge you with is that the idea of coexistence and conservation, in my mind, are essentially the same thing. You can't have one without the other on a human-inhabited landscape. If we're going to conserve wildlife, we have to coexist with it. And so that's kind of the theme of tonight's talk. And we're gonna focus. This is about the North Cascades, but it's gonna be a very Methouse-centric talk because that's what I know best, and that's where a lot of the work's actually occurred also for some of the species we're gonna talk about. And just maybe one more housekeeping item. There's a lot of photographs in this. A lot of them are mine. Some of them are from WDFW or Forest Service staff that worked on projects. And where I could, I gave photo credits to individuals. But just a lot of people always ask about the photos, so I thought I'd tell you that up front. And the animals pictured in this presentation tonight are all, I can't say all, but almost all actual North Cascades individual animals. I tried to use only photos of animals that are actually part of this ecosystem. There's a few exceptions. You'll probably figure out which ones those are. And I think that's it. So we'll get going.
All right, so I also want to extend a thank you to you all for being here. This is super fun. Last time we did this together, it was our first time presenting as a father-daughter duo. I've grown up going to a lot of my dad's talks, so it was kind of fun to be up here with him and sharing the limelight a little bit. I credit most of my teaching abilities to his wonderful example that he's set for me over the time. So I just wanted to say a quick thank you to you, Dad, so thank you.
Thank you.
But before we get going, it's really, really important to do a land acknowledgement. So I do want to acknowledge that we are on the traditional land of the first people of the Methow Valley and the Methow First People, past, present, and honoring with gratitude the land itself and the Methow tribe. We acknowledge that we work and live on the unceded ancestral lands of the Methow people, and through tonight's discussion, we aim to respect and honor their ancient heritage and stewardship of this land. So keeping this in mind as we move forward through this talk, we're not gonna dive too much into indigenous culture here, because that's just not our place to discuss, but honoring them through just remembering and learning throughout the night. In addition, we're gonna be talking about coexistence, like my dad said. So the most important thing we can remember when it comes to the indigenous people is that coexistence has been here since time immemorial. So for 13,000 years, the Methow people have and currently live and coexist with this land sustainably. And so remembering that, and how can we honor that? It's by learning, listening, and trying to become better stewards ourselves. So that being said, we are gonna talk about the Methow Valley. We're gonna talk about post-colonial Methow Valley, mostly looking at the past 30 plus years or so here in the valley. And so we are gonna also be talking about primarily wildlife. That being said, remembering that biodiversity also includes plants, fungi, and insects. They are vitally important. We would not have wildlife here today if we did not have those things, but we are going to focus primarily on wildlife. These are just a few of the mentions. To take time to mention all the individuals that worked on projects that we're going to talk about tonight would take a whole talk in itself. So we just wanted to throw up some logos here to honor the people that have done these amazing projects. So just a thank you and a recognition to all of these organizations.
All righty. So why is coexistence important? And why are we here gathered to discuss this topic? Well, there's a couple of main reasons, I guess. I mean, there's a lot of philosophical reasons, but two that I want to highlight are, number one, that it's a public trust. It's mandated in a lot of the mission statements and guiding documents of the various land management and wildlife management agencies. And so, for instance, Guiding Principle 4 in Washington's Comprehensive Wildlife Conservation Strategy right up front says, emphasize biodiversity conservation. And again, coexistence and conservation go hand in hand. And I think almost more importantly, we are interested in this because of public values. It's a desired thing. People, in my experience, people almost universally appreciate wildlife. They may appreciate it in different ways or experience it in different ways, but rarely do you find an individual who, you know, for lack of a better term, doesn't have any appreciation for wildlife. And so I think there's just a hunger to continue to share the planet with these other creatures. And we recognize that in our documents too. So for instance, one of our strategic goals is sustainable fish and wildlife related opportunities. And in another way to think about this too is that the natural world's really an important part of our emotional and psychological well-being, and that's not just me telling you that. That's like a stack of research this high from psychologists and others. And so there's, I suppose you could argue somewhat selfish reasons to want to maintain these animals on the landscape as well. Or to put it in a nutshell, I like to say nature is the original emotional support animal.
So why do we do so much sustainable conservation work here in the Valley? Well, let me tell you. So as you can see here, we live in a place that has tremendous, huge amounts of space that is uninhabited. It's large, contiguous land that has a core of wilderness. And so that huge swath of land is also open to huge habitat ranges. So there's a lot of species out here that have really big habitat ranges, and this area allows for that. And so this is a great example. Huge space of uninhabited, contiguous land. Also within that swath of land, we have a really, really wide diversity of habitats, whether that's climatic, geographic, or elevational. And all of that allows for a really, really broad diversity of wildlife. And so we can see here everything from animals that are alpine all the way down to riparian and plains animals. And so that leads to this type of diversity you see here. You know, we have snakes, chickadees, deer, black bear, lynx, bats, etc. Really, really large diversity of animals. That's why this place is so special and is such a great groundwork spot for this type of research.
Alrighty, so to appreciate the fact that, you know, we're enjoying a relatively robust and biodiverse ecosystem now, you have to understand where we came from. And so, you know, I promised this was going to be a positive talk, and it is, but for a little context, we have to go back and talk about what I'm going to call the era of non-coexistence. And, you know, essentially a brief history of post-colonial North American wildlife exploitation, the emphasis being on exploitation. So as an example, one of the first waves of exploitation came with the fur trappers in the early 1800s. And as they moved west, they pretty much trapped everything that had a soft pelt. Beavers were particularly valuable and targeted probably more than any other species. And just, you know, you don't need to understand all the specifics of the colors on the graph or whatever. All you need to know is, we started off with somewhere probably around 200 million beavers in North America, and today we're down to about 9 million, give or take, and that's up from where it was a few decades ago. So we really cleaned beavers out of the landscape in the early 1800s. As that century rolled on, so did the railroad. The railroad moved west, and with the railroad came extensive market hunting, and also pretty extensive predator control efforts. I mean, this is probably a whole talk in and of itself, but I just wanted to give you a picture of like how completely we impacted the landscape back in those days. That pile of bison skulls is, it's a very famous picture. You see in a lot of history books on this subject. And the take-home message is we went from somewhere around maybe 50 or 60 million bison to 90, down to 90 in Yellowstone Park within a relatively short period of time. The amount of carnage is kind of hard to fathom, frankly. And that, so this era of market hunting, there were a lot of, there were some extinctions. We actually have some species that no longer exist. Passenger pigeons, for instance, come to mind. But a lot of extirpations where species were eliminated locally or regionally also. And, you know, as the railroad and market hunting moved west, so did settlers. And with settlers came other pressures on wildlife, essentially. So a lot of the early settlers were subsistence living off the land, including the animals themselves. Their livestock was typically their livelihood. So when they could, they would fill their larders with wild game meat. So that was additional pressure. And then there were other pressures associated with settlement or colonization. Livestock came with settlers, and you know, predators were seen as a threat, and so they were persecuted pretty hard, and there were a lot of animals that were actually persecuted because of their potential to eat crops or orchards, for instance. And one that a lot of people don't think about or maybe recognize as something that occurred here on this landscape is jackrabbits. When you look at the historical counts from the early 1900s, jackrabbits were so thick on the landscape, both here in the Methow and in the Okanagan Valley, that they would have drives to try to kill as many as they could. And when that wasn't successful, they would have poisoning campaigns. And they were, ultimately, they were pretty successful in eliminating most of those animals. Even something as innocuous as a badger was often targeted because badgers dig holes that cattle and horse can step in. And so, you know, fairly widespread era of non-coexistence. So just as an example, and this was true throughout the West, and it definitely impacted us here in the North Cascades as well. It just got here maybe a little bit later than in some of the other areas, because this was essentially the last area homesteaded. But here's an example. So this slide comes from the Loomis area, which is just to the northeast of here a little bit, on the east slope of the North Cascades. And that's one season's take of pelts from one trap line. And in that photograph, there's at least 17 lynx pelts and 5 marten and looks like a mink and then a bunch of weasels. So that just gives you an idea of what kind of pressure we were putting on some of these critters. And so, you know, what was the fallout here locally from that era? Well, 3 of these 4 animals disappeared entirely from the state of Washington, not just the North Cascades, but the entire state of Washington, and that would be the fisher, the wolf, and the wolverine. And we think the last individuals of all 3 of those species vanished somewhere probably in the 30s, but they were, you know, the populations were much reduced even before that. Grizzly bears are kind of an interesting story. They hung on in very small numbers into the middle and even late part of the 20th century. So the last grizzly bear verified south of the border in the North Cascades was 1996. That particular photograph there is a bear near the east entrance of Manning Park in 2015. So there may still be a bear or two on the British Columbia side, but as far as we know, there are no grizzly bears right now south of the border in Washington. Other critters actually weathered the storm. So lynx hung on. They certainly took a hit in terms of numbers. Same thing with mountain goats. We talked about beavers already. They didn't lose a lot of habitat, or their distribution didn't change a lot. They just suffered from a loss of numbers. Versus some other species, like sharp-tailed grouse, rattlesnakes, loons, and western gray squirrel, these guys lost a lot of habitat because they tended to occur in areas where people like to settle. And so in addition to some direct harvest or take, there were habitat issues that put pressure on some of these critters as well. I think the other thing sometimes that's surprising to people is how thoroughly we also cleaned the ungulates off of the landscape. So for instance, bighorn sheep and moose disappeared entirely from the state of Washington, and in fact, bighorn sheep disappeared from almost the entire West, outside of some isolated bands down in the desert country. Elk also, believe it or not, disappeared from pretty much all of North America, with the exception of a small group in Jackson Hole and a small group in Olympic National Park. And in fact, Olympic National Park was originally created to protect Roosevelt elk. Even mule deer, something we think of as a really common species, sometimes to the point of nuisance, you know, if it's they're eating your roses, was vastly reduced in numbers, both here locally as well as throughout the West. So we get to the end of the 19th century, and people looked around and thought, wow, maybe it's time to try something different. And no, that's not actually a 19th century photograph, obviously, but I think it's a great metaphor for the kind of landscape we had created towards the end of that century. That's actually the Tunk Valley after the Tunk Valley fire. That landscape actually looks really good right now. So let's see, this is, by the way, this is kind of the lecture part of the talk. It will get better, I promise. now I'm gonna call, what I'm gonna call the next section is the era of post-apocalyptic coexistence. So about the turn of the century is when the tide started to change. And it's not like things got rosy all of a sudden. There's a lot of fits and starts and wailing and gnashing of teeth. Change is always hard, but we did start to go in the opposite direction. Just for those of you in the room who are hunters, who have hunted, can you imagine a one-page hunting pamphlet? That was the hunting pamphlet from 1905, 1906. Really quickly, just to give you a framework of what was going on in the 20th century that made recovery of a lot of these species possible. So around the turn of the century was when we really codified a lot of the boundaries of our big public land holdings, and a lot of the agencies we're all familiar with now, like the Forest Service, the Park Service, Biological Survey, and others. That's when they got going. In Washington here locally, so middle part of the second decade, the state starts passing legislation to regulate game and fish take. And then in the 30s, along comes Aldo Leopold, who, I mean, many considered essentially the father of modern wildlife management, and he really was a pivotal figure. But the thing that made Leopold different, or the paradigm shift he brought to the realm of wildlife management, was he was the first one to really recognize the importance of biodiversity, or what we might call today ecosystem management. And he also recognized that we were better off if we managed wildlife as a public trust rather as something just to profit from in the short term. And he also appreciated the importance of science in guiding some of our decision making and policies. So about that same time, here in Washington in 1932, we get the first iteration of what is now the Washington Department of Fish and Wildlife. In 37, the Pittman-Robertson Act passes, which is a tax on guns and ammunition that was used, essentially doled out to the states to give them the funds they needed to begin managing fish and wildlife. And a really cool local note on that is one of the first things that Washington did with their PR funds was to buy our first two wildlife areas. The first one was in the Sinlahecan, just over the hill, and the second one was right here in the Methow Valley. And I'd be remiss if I didn't mention the Federal Endangered Species Act. That was a really pivotal moment in wildlife conservation. And then I threw the last one in there because to me it's significant. In 1987, we changed our name from the Game Department to the Washington Department of Fish and Wildlife, or at that time just wildlife. And that was when the agency was beginning to recognize a much more holistic approach to management. It wasn't just deer and elk and some game birds, it was the whole package. And so we reflected that in our name change. Alrighty, let's move on to better stuff. So all that happens in the background, and then how did that translate into on-the-ground recovery of some of these species? Well, just regulating harvest was really all we needed for some of these animals. So moose, for instance, began to increase both in numbers and distribution. And I, even within my career, I've seen moose grow in both numbers and distribution here locally in the valley. And that has occurred in a lot of places in the West. White-tailed deer, actually, not only did their numbers rebound, but their geographic range expanded, in part because of some of the changes that came with settlers actually benefited white-tailed deer, and so they actually expanded their range compared to what it was post-colonial, or pre-colonial, excuse me. And then mule deer, of course, particularly those of you who have been around here for, you know, half a century or so, you've seen mule deer numbers that a lot of people probably wouldn't even believe. You know, back in the middle part of the 20th century, we had a lot more deer on the landscape even than we do today. It was kind of a perfect storm of factors that allowed for that. It was kind of probably a one-time thing that really wasn't sustainable, but it was interesting while it lasted. But we certainly have healthy populations of deer now. Some of the other critters needed a little more help. So I mentioned that bighorn sheep were pretty much gone from the West, and throughout the West, sheep from British Columbia were used to rebuild herds. In our case, the first sheep were brought into the Sinlahiquan wildlife area that I mentioned was our very first wildlife area, and from there, we repopulated several herds within Washington. Elk also had to basically be reintroduced in many places in the West, and that included the North Cascades. Elk were put into the North Cascades, and the elk we have now, particularly in the southern half of the North Cascades, were a result of those efforts. Some of our more common carnivores that did not get extirpated, you know, they survived the onslaught, although in reduced numbers. Again, just regulating harvest allowed these guys to come back. And currently, we have very healthy black bear populations. Bobcat populations are probably as high as at any time in my career, I would argue, locally. Our cougar populations are strong and I would argue, pretty stable. And that's a function of maybe the management of the last 10 or 15 years and some tweaks we've made to the way we harvest cougars. And marten have come back pretty remarkably, too. There's drainages here in the Methow where I'm always amazed at how many marten tracks I see. All right, where are we at here? Oh yeah, fun video, okay. All right, so the point of this video that I wanted to make, in addition to being a fun video, is that you know, it's important to have predators back on the landscape because they play an important role in our ecosystems, i.e. they typically kill and eat ungulates, at least our large predators. Real quick, I want to mention these three species because the endangered species, this sort of highlights why the Endangered Species Act is important. So these guys weren't really persecuted all that much in the original wave I talked about earlier, but as we got into the middle of the 20th century and post-World War II and the use of DDT when it was invented and then widespread, used in a very widespread manner, these guys really took it in the shorts and their numbers began to plummet. The Rachel Carlson's Silent Spring book was one of the advocacy pieces of the advocacy puzzle that helped get the Endangered Species Act passed. And when DDT was banned, these guys actually came back pretty strongly and remarkably. And some ospreys pretty much all on their own. There are so many osprey nests in Okanagan County now, it kind of blows my mind. Bald eagles, we gave them a little help. We protected nest trees and did a few other regulatory or management-related things, but they pretty much came back on their own. And peregrine falcons, same way. We did a little bit of reintroduction with peregrine falcon, but bottom line, all three of these species now are doing well here locally as well as throughout Washington. Okay, the rare carnivores, particularly the large rare carnivores, you know, are kind of the ones that are that have lagged behind in some ways, and part of that is because they come with some socio-political aspects that some of the other critters don't come with. And this comic is one of my favorites of Eric Brooks. I think it's just really clever, so I'll let you read it. But, you know, these two species in particular can create fairly polarized views. But in many cases, come back they did. And so real quickly, let's touch on this suite of critters here. So the two on the right, wolves and wolverines, came back entirely on their own. I'll tell you a little bit more about that in a minute. Lynx, as I mentioned earlier, were never extirpated. Fisher, we had to do a little bit of reintroduction effort with, and grizzly bears are an ongoing story. All right, one by one. So wolves, they showed up, they were starting to trickle into Washington in probably by the mid-80s. I saw my first wolf track at Hozamine in 1989. And then as the years progressed, they finally kind of, I think, reached a critical mass with enough individuals. Well, let me back up. I forgot the key phrase for this entire slide. Unequivocally, wolves made it to Washington on their own. I did not bring them in Schwann's trucks. You know, they didn't. Despite whatever alternative facts you hear on social media or elsewhere, they got here on their own. They're really good dispersers, and it's not a problem for them to go hundreds of miles when they're dispersing to new territories. So after kind of the initial fits and starts in the 80s and 90s, wolves finally got kind of enough of a critical mass and momentum, and by probably about 2005 or so, we probably had a pack somewhere here nearby that we hadn't even verified yet. But by 2008, we verified the lookout pack, the first pack with pups that had been verified in Washington State in like 70 years. And that was right here in the Menhow Valley, south of Twisp. That upper right is the second breeding female or breeding male of the lookout pack. And that photo on the left is the very first litter we documented, six pups. And from there, you know, it's been a steady progression of recovery. In the Northeast, we've got quite a few packs. We've got at least four packs here now in Okanagan County. I suspect we've got a couple more than that. And we've got, this is last year's report. So that summarizes what we knew at the end of 2021. Our new report will come out probably in about a month, and there will be some more circles added to that map, I'm pretty confident. Yeah. So that was a chorus howl of a couple of adults and a group of pups from the Sullivan Creek Pack, which is south of Highway 20, you know, southeast of Twisp, essentially. And that was from last summer.
I just have to mention, growing up as this one's daughter, the number of times I was in a tent out in the middle of the woods, and he was, you know, putting away the food, suddenly I would hear howling. As a 10-year-old or however old I was, it would scare the bejesus out of me, and this one was just trying to see if there are wolves out there. So every time I hear howling, I get a little bit of a twitch.
Wolverines. A species near and dear to me. I'm sure many of you know we had a 10-year wolverine project here locally a little while back, and their history, like I mentioned earlier, they disappeared from the state, and it's kind of an interesting case because we have genetic samples from historically trapped animals, and we also have genetic samples from the ones that we radio collared 10 or 15 years ago. And what we know from that is the haplotypes, the genetic haplotypes of those two groups of animals is completely different, and that's why we know that we actually extirpated wolverines from Washington. But they have come back in fairly aggressive fashion. So those two pictures on the left are from 1997. Those are the first two remote camera pictures that John Rohr and I ever got of wolverines, and that's up by Hart's Pass. Long story short, that was the beginning of a series of sort of data collection points that led to a study of wolverines here locally, and there have been a bunch of other monitoring efforts since. Run polls, we can identify individual wolverines if we don't have DNA from their chest patch markings, which is kind of cool. Long story short, they now occupy most of their historic range, probably in Washington State. We have breeding females as far south as Mount Rainier now, so pretty exciting. Yeah, something to cheer about. Fisher reintroduction. So fishers, again, we extirpated them. They were a really high value fur animal, so they were really, really targeted with trapping efforts. And it became apparent that they weren't going to come back on their own unless we gave them some help. So reintroduction efforts started in the Olympics, and I don't remember the exact year, and then it moved to the South Cascades, and then in 2018, the effort to reintroduce them to the North Cascades started. And so that graph on the left, it shows you sort of the general study area outlined there in the light yellow, and then all those dots are locations of various kinds, whether it's telemetry locations or camera sites. And the take-home message is they are taking up residence. We've documented reproduction and fishers, and anything in the weasel family disperses pretty well. And so we've had fishers here in the Methow. These two pictures on the right, the one in the bottom is from Wolf Creek. The one, the upper right, is up near 30 Mile Meadows area, Thunder Mountain, essentially. And that was last summer? Lynx. So as I mentioned, we didn't lose lynx. We probably suffered some fairly steep declines early on, but I think they rebounded from that early trapping pressure to where they were fairly stable. And now the issue is with our big fires, you know, what's that doing to our lynx habitat and our carrying capacity? And so that's kind of an ongoing question that we'll touch on again a little bit later. Grizzly bears, they're the one maybe that's the least positive of those original five that I showed you. You know, there's been a long ongoing effort to potentially restore them or at least evaluate options for doing so. And I started my career as a grizzly bear gray wolf investigations biologist running around the North Cascades looking for bears and wolves in 1989. Here we are in 2023, and we haven't moved the ball very far with this species. It's been ups and downs, and you know, one step forward, two steps back, and vice versa. Bottom line, we got to the point where we were developing an EIS, and I was part of that team to evaluate options for restoring bears. It got tabled under the last presidential administration. It's now back on the table. And we're fast tracking it, and we'll probably have that done. I think the timeline is by next spring. So that'll lay out potential EIS alternatives for grizzly restoration. All righty, now you don't have to listen to me talk for a while. You get Amy back.
All right, so I want to bring this. We just heard some awesome things that the department has done, big organizations have done. I want to bring this more to a context that all of us can understand at a more personal level, and that is through something called ethic of care. So bringing the animals back on the landscape is not the end-all be-all. There's more to the story, and that's going to be how do we exist on the landscape with these animals, and how do we relate to them on a personal level? And so this image was chosen very specifically. Does anybody recognize where this is? Nope. So this is the gun ranch. So this is a WDFW gun ranch conservation easement. And so this space has a lot of really popular trails that I'm sure many of you have been on. It's a really, really good example of sustainable trail use and also has really suitable and diverse habitat for wildlife. And so what is ethic of care? Let's talk about that just a little bit more. I like to talk about it as the changing of narrative from conquering or occupying the land, instead to building empathetic relationships with the land to promote ethical stewardship. So that's a lot of buzzwords thrown right at you, but that basically means that when you're on the land, you're thinking about how you're interacting at it with purpose. And so how are you building relationships? And that's something I think the Methow specifically is really awesome at. The people in the Methow are really, really awesome at this. And so not just using the land as a resource or as a personal space to recreate without extra thought. And so I think when we occupy the land, we think about how are we interacting, what are our impacts on the space, and how can we build a relationship that can also be intergenerational. And so growing up here, personally, I know that that was something that me and my peers really felt as young people here, and I know a lot of you have imbibed onto your children or grandchildren or other young people in your life. And so it's an intergenerational concept of how you build those empathetic relationships. You take that extra thought about what you're stepping on, what you're interacting with, what your sounds do to the environment around you. So that's something we need to think about when we're thinking about how we coexist on the landscape here. And then also I really like this quote. Lissy Goralnik is a PhD researcher out in Montana, and she really focuses on ethical work in field work specifically. And so this quote says, "Be driven by an appropriate environmental ethic, one that bridges relationships, focuses on connections, and applies simultaneously to the human and more than human world." And so that term up there, careful to careful. I do want to mention really quickly. With that careful to careful mindset, does anybody know where this picture is?
We had a backup one.
Oh, no. Just kidding, go. This one. I heard it out here, Maple Pass. This is Heather Maple Pass. And so up at Heather Maple Pass, there's a really big effort to regrow the plant life up there, right? The heather specifically, because it's gotten trampled so bad by a lot of visitors, especially now, right? The traffic up there has just been bonkers, which it's exciting that people are getting out in the landscape and getting to experience this beautiful place. We can't take that away from them because we don't own this place. This is not a place that we've conquered and owned. It's for everybody to enjoy. However, using that careful to careful mindset of how you approach that space. And so you're caring not just about a space, but caring for. It's just a slight shift of thinking about that. So I'm gonna say that again. Caring about, instead of caring about, I want you to care for. So it's just a little bit of a shift in how you understand your space and how you create those relationships. So a great example of that here in the Valley, I have two examples of projects that really use an ethic of care in their research, and the first being the Methow Beaver Project. So the Methow Beaver Project really focuses on the human front-facing interactions of beavers, and so a lot of people consider these animals to be nuisances. I think they're adorable, but some people find them to be nuisances because, you know, they can destroy properties, they can destroy fence lines, they can flood your property. They're just trying to do their beaver things. But that conflict is something that the Methow Beaver Project has really, really tackled with an ethic of care and getting folks to understand why beavers do what they do and to really respect the animal. And so the Methow Beaver Project steps in, removes beavers as needed. Lots of times they try and talk to the owners, get them to interact with the beavers in a positive way. Maybe we'll just shift where they're cutting down all of your beautiful trees. But in the effort of when we do remove them, I got to personally work on this project, so I have a personal stake in this. This was super fun. We'll move these beavers up the watershed, so up in elevation, up watershed, and as a result, create these beautiful habitats that really contributes to healthy ecosystems. So it's just kind of a win-win, you know, helping people get beavers out of their yard, but then also contributing to these beautiful habitats. And then the other project I wanted to talk about is the Rattlesnake Project. And so up there, you can see me and John Rohr pit tagging a rattlesnake. I want to shout out John Rohr because he was the instrumental beginner of this project. And this is another one where we're looking at people front-facing with rattlesnakes. And so a lot of people don't like rattlesnakes on their property, understandably. But understanding that these snakes are really, really vital in the landscape. They're really good rodent control, right? That's what they're doing. They're just out there eating mice. They're really not out there to get you and your pets. And so translating that information to folks and getting them to respect their space and to maybe not first instinct get a shovel, put the shovel away. Instead, call John Rohr or call my dad or call someone who's comfortable to come get these snakes and get them off of your property. And in that ethic of care way of caring about these animals and their well-being, contributing to this broader project that looks at where these animals are moving across the valley, which has been a really awesome endeavor. I'm looking forward to the day that you all publish that data and become super famous, and it'll be great. So those are two examples of some really awesome projects that are ethic of care based, if that makes sense, to put that into context of how you care about the animals and their well-being while also contributing to a broader project here. And so this is a great example of how people can coexist on the landscape with other animals. I don't know if this is going to play. I'm going to give it a shot. If not, Bridger, you might need to step in. Yes.
Thank you.
So that was just an example there of a spot that the Lunatic Creek crossing that many of you have probably been on. And that's a great example of how many species you coexist with in that spot. There's so many different animals passing through there when you're not there. It's pretty cool to watch the footage. It's kind of sometimes closer than you think past people when animals go through, which is pretty cool.
All righty, what's next? Okay, informing coexistence. So, you know, part of coexisting and conserving animals is learning a bit about them so we can make smart decisions about how to coexist with them. So just real quickly, I want to touch on a few projects, each one of which could be a talk in and of itself. Wolverine research. So as I mentioned before, we had the good fortune here of having a 10-year project on wolverines where we radio collared and followed animals. And since I used that picture in kind of the trailer for this talk of Amy on the left, I better tell the story. So one year, we were coming up to the Christmas break, and the crew, John was going to, who was the field lead on this project, was going to be out of town for 3 or 4 days over Christmas, and we were debating whether or not to leave traps open. I said, oh, sure, I'll be around, and Lindsay and Adam, the two crew members, are still here, so let's leave them open. I mean, what are the odds we're going to get a wolverine anyway, right? We only catch maybe 4 a year. So, of course, Christmas Eve in the morning, we get the little signal sent to us, there's something in the trap. Crew goes up, sure enough, it's a wolverine. So I'm thinking, well, 3 of us. It'd be nice to have another body or 2. All right, conscript the family. Wife and daughter, suit up. We're going to go catch a wolverine. And so that's what we did Christmas Eve. I don't remember exactly what year that was, but really cold. I do remember that. But we successfully collared an animal we called Dasher. And it was a really unforgettable evening. And if you have wondered what it's like to catch wolverines, this video will give you just a really quick idea.
I'd come down a little more than that.
Yeah. That's what it's like to catch wolverines. I have two flashlights that that have bite marks that I hang on to proudly. Alrighty, next up. Oh, just to say too, so even though we don't catch wolverines anymore, we're still monitoring them through a variety of different projects, and we're trying to develop kind of a long-term monitoring strategy that everybody that's involved can use. And it's been a great project because there's been a lot of NGOs and other individuals involved outside of just the agencies. Wolves. We could do a couple of talks on wolves in Washington. We continue to monitor wolves both with radio telemetry and with remote cameras to give us an idea of their numbers and distribution and how, you know, where we are in terms of recovery goals that are outlined in our wolf management plan. But I specifically wanted to throw this picture in on the left here because that's Harriet Allen. And Harriet Allen was extremely instrumental in getting the current wolf management and recovery plan done and implemented. And without her, I don't think it would have happened. And that the animal she's holding is the very first wolf radio collared in Washington. That was the original breeding female in the lookout pack. Lynx research and monitoring. So we also did a lynx study back 10 or 15 years ago where we collared lynx, and we were really at that point, we were really concerned and interested about how lynx were responding to the giant fires we were beginning to have, particularly the tripod fire, because that burned right through the heart of our lynx habitat. And then more recently, go back one more, we've also done some remote camera work to get a more current picture of the occupancy on the landscape here locally. Where do we have lynx, and in a rough sense, where we have reproducing animals. And I just had to create that slide because it's got both of us on it, and we both worked on this project, father and daughter, and that was really fun. But the most exciting news relative to lynx right now is that there's a brand new project that started, and it's really neat because that's Carmen Van Bianchi on the left there. And in the bottom, that's Carmen back in, 2010 or 11, maybe. And that's her as of Saturday in the upper left. And this is the first year of this new project that's going to build on what we learned before, because now we're 17 years post-tripod burn. So the landscape looks a lot different now, and we want to know how lynx are responding to that regrowth. The early returns, just from the tracks we're seeing up there, suggest it's pretty darn favorably. And Home Range is Carmen's new nonprofit that's doing this work. So it's not necessarily the agencies even leading this time. It's a local nonprofit that's front and center on this, which I think is great. And I got to go out and actually immobilize the cat for them on Saturday. So they have their first study animal on the air. And I'm sure Home Range will have information on their website as they progress. So if you want to get details, go to their website and take a look. And here's, I think there's a fun video. Yep, another fun video. If you notice, they have giant feet. They have built-in snowshoes. That's the niche that they occupy, deep, soft snow. They're the softest animal you'll ever touch, and they're one of the least agitated when they're in a trap. Like, I walked up to the trap and just used a little jab stick and just jabbed it without, you know, any fanfare. Your wolverine's a little different, yeah. you might lose body parts if you do it wrong with a wolverine. Okay. Is this still me, habitat? Yeah. So, I mean, you know, we've talked a lot about getting animals back on the landscape, about learning about animals, about ethic of care, learning how to coexist with them as individuals and as groups. But none of that really matters if we don't have habitat to support these animals. And so as all this other work was going on to recover the animals themselves, there was also a lot of work going on to maintain and in some cases enhance habitat so that they would be able to stay on the landscape. So, and that really, you know, I mentioned some of the early wildlife areas, some of the early funding was used to purchase wildlife areas, and then there was kind of a, I mean, that continued at a slow pace for a while, but then from about 1990 to the current time, there was a program initiated in Washington that is currently called the RCO program, or the Recreation Conservation Organization program, and it has dedicated funding for critical wildlife habitat. So between 1990 and current, the public land base in the Met How changed significantly. So run that back if you can one more time. That's where we were pre-1990. Everything in color is some sort of publicly owned land. All that added stuff is additional publicly owned land and or conservation easements. And so not only was it a significant addition, but it was strategic. Because when we started looking around at what we had, we realized, okay, we got this giant sea of Forest Service land, but a lot of it's upper elevation. Where we don't have enough protection is shrub steppe, riparian, and some of the lowland dry forest habitats. So that's what we really focused on. The other thing we were really conscious of was trying to maintain connectivity on the landscape, hence the yellow arrows. We were trying to create cross-valley links to keep the landscape permeable for animals. Now, that little circle that just appeared near Winthrop, keep that in the back of your minds. We're going to talk about that here in a few more slides. And a lot of that work that I just mentioned was Department of Fish and Wildlife in concert with the Met How Conservancy doing easements simultaneously. But it's not just organizations or agencies that are engaged in this. So some of you, and you know, when the need arises, one of the neat things about this valley is the citizens themselves come together and rally for a cause like no other community I've been in, I think. And that's one of the reasons that this is such a special place. So a few years ago, I'm sure many of you remember, there was a proposal to put an open pit copper mine in the upper valley. Would have changed things dramatically, to say the least. But we rallied, and we, as a group, collectively, I don't think I've ever seen a community more unanimous about something in my life. You know, we made it clear that this was not the place for an open pit copper mine, and the outcome was the largest mineral withdrawal in the history of the program. 300 plus thousand acres. So, you know, give yourself a pat on the back for that. So, I'm super excited and inspired by all the cool things that have happened here in terms of both wildlife recovery and coexistence, and I'm constantly inspired by the landscape, the critters, and the people, but not just for what's been behind us, but what lies ahead and the opportunities that we have right in front of us currently.
So that leads us to the campaign for the Sunny M Ranch. I'm going to go into that just a little bit more specifically here. So for those of you who maybe don't know exactly what this campaign is, it's the Conservancy is looking to raise private and public funds to buy the remaining 1,200 acres of the Sunny M Ranch. And so that portion of land right there is going to be massively important. You can see, I'll just kind of lay it out. Many of you know where this is, but it's just going to be on the north side of Patterson Mountain, just outside of town. It includes a bunch of really, really important and fun trails that are open to the public. There's a huge, huge range of trails right in there that many of you have been on. And so that chunk of land is going to be represented by the red in there, is what is being looked to be fully purchased. And so this area is super important because it is also a biodiversity microcosm. And so what we mean by that is that it has all of the facets that we've been needing and using for all of the work that we've been talking about tonight. And so what are those facets specifically? One of them is connectivity. So remember that map earlier, the little yellow circle? So that little yellow circle is that red blop right there. And so that connectivity is going to be meeting that red blop to all those other colors, which are protected land areas. And so that connectivity is going to be able to linkage across the valley. So getting that link across the valley with that area of land right there. The other important part is that it's really, really diverse habitat. And so in this area, that's the low elevation habitat that we've been talking about. That's really important. So in this space, we have plains, we have shrub steppe, we also have dry forest, and then we have wetlands and riparian areas. Super diverse. It's gonna house a really, really diverse range of wildlife in this spot. So not only is it really, really accessible for folks to use recreationally in a really beautiful spot, but it's also going to house a bunch of different wildlife and really diverse habitat. So that is why this area is super important. Here's some fun wildlife diversity photos for you.
So the salamander there on the right crawled out of the wetland there on the Sunny M and showed up at my front door one year.
So we asked the local wildlife what they thought about this proposal and how they felt about having an area protected, and this is what their response was.
Thank you.
So a couple of quick comments on that. Number one, if you watched that and you didn't at least smile, I'm worried about you. Number two, all of those animals spend part or all of their time on the Sunny M Ranch, those actual individual animals. All righty, is this still me? What are we talking about here? Oh yeah, so the other neat thing about this project, the Sunny M, is not only are we protecting these habitats, but as Amy mentioned, we've got quite a trail network here, and so we have the opportunity to practice coexistence with wildlife on this landscape, and maybe even try new things to further coexistence from a recreation standpoint. Similarly, we've got irrigated ag here too, and we've got wildlife using that ag, so we can have a demonstration area here also for how we can coexist with agriculture.
And then we have one more little montage. I know we've kept you pretty late, but one more little montage of pictures for you, so if you can just hold tight, we're almost done.
Again, all of those animals were either on or immediately adjacent to the Sunny M.
All right, so we just wanted to extend a thank you. Thank you to all of you for being here tonight. Thank you to the Conservancy.